My name is Anna Thelen. I am 23. I'm working as a chemistry technician. I work with medicine, mostly pills, capsules, tablets. I break them down into a liquid form and mix them with different chemicals, and we test them. I really like it. It's really interesting to me because I can do things with my hands and do experiments and see things like colors change and different reactions.
We are a quality assurance lab. We are making sure that what it says on the bottle, says on the labels, is what's actually in it.
We have a pretty large microbiology lab that tests for safety of different food products and the quantity and presence of active ingredients in dietary supplements.
I went to Rochester Institute of Technology. I graduated with a Lab Science and Technology Associate's degree. I can work with biomedical, environmental science, biology, nursing, anything like that.
When I found out that Anna was deaf, at first I was like, I don't know how well she'll be able to understand us with all this scientific lingo.
My major concern was that people won't want to interact with me because they don't know sign language or they don't know how to communicate with a deaf person. So I have to approach them and show them what to do.
Teach us so that we can sign from across.
Having that extra focus on effective communication, you start to realize that you really do need to rely on each other to be able to get everything accomplished that needs to be done in a day.
You've already checked that your standard amounts were updated properly.
Anna's a hard worker. She'll do anything that I ask of her. She's reliable. She's a team player. I don't think we could do what we do every day without having a good team environment.
You know, you're over there and I'm here and I'm like... It's nice to be able to speak in her language.
She shows us a few signs here and there and we try to pick up on as much as we can. So we've been slowly learning.
When I came in here first, I was a little doubtful about how it would work out. And maybe not sure about how hearing people would look at me as being a deaf worker. But after a little while, they got used to the idea of having a deaf person be here.
As scientists, our first job is to learn and to understand things. And someone who is deaf is just another thing to figure out. So me and Brittany jumped on the chance to be able to learn sign language because it's fun.
The opening and closing injections, are they good?
Sure. Okay. I like employers to keep an open mind when working with deaf people and be willing to learn new things, new ways to communicate, such as learning a little bit of sign language themselves or learning how to gesture.
Lab sciences are a field that need more diversity, and you need your mind first, you know, not your ears.
I really do like this job, and I like working here. I can imagine myself here for 5-10 years, and I could see myself becoming a supervisor with the department.
Well, good morning, everybody. Glad you're all here. We're in the last day of our great ATE conference. Glad to see you. Before I introduce the person who's going to introduce our speaker, somebody has left a phone behind in a bathroom in a phone case. So if you've lost your phone, let us know. Go to the ATE registration desk at the top of the stairs where you got your badge when you first checked in. And if you can correctly identify the phone, they'll probably give it to you. So right now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce my division director, the division director of the Division of Research on Learning in Formal and Informal Settings, Dr. Evan Hite. Evan is a founding faculty member at the University of California, Merced. He's been our division director for 2 years now? Yeah, about 2 years. He's an amazing guy. He's one of those 60-second managers, you know, so something comes across his desk and he delegates it and it's done. And I've been very impressed with Evan so far. So, Evan, come on up and introduce our speaker.
Good morning, and thank you very much, Dave. I just wanted to start off by thanking everyone here for their participation and their contributions to the work of the National Science Foundation. So you probably know that NSF is the nation's science agency, but you might not know that when it was founded in 1950, it was right from the very start given the dual mission of advancing the nation's science and also advancing the nation's science education. And the ATA program is a very big part of that, so I would like to think that because ATE is a program of the National Science Foundation, it benefits from the expertise, the visibility being part of the nation's science agency, but at the same time that the work of ATE awardees, participants, contributes to the nation's science as well. It's a very good relationship that is mutually beneficial, so I think that the work of people here and folks who are participating, students participating in your programs, are contributing very much to what we're doing at NSF, so thank you very much. It's also my great honor to introduce the speaker today. We've just had an enjoyable chat this morning over breakfast, so Sheila Forte-Tramell is an expert on many different aspects of HR, but particularly on leadership and mentorship, two topics that are so important and so appropriate to be talking about. Among her accomplishments, she's led a global mentorship efforts at IBM, and I think she'll be talking about that. She has numerous publications, but books and articles. She's won many awards, including two Meritorious Service Awards from UNCF. I think, but based on our chat earlier, this is going to be a very interesting, very inspiring talk. So the title of Sheila's talk is Leadership in the 21st Century, and welcome and thank you.
Good morning. Well, are you excited about this experience? Awesome. Well, earlier this year, I visited Wake Technical Community College in Raleigh, North Carolina. And I gave a talk, and I intend to share some of what I shared with them with you today. So having said that, my talk today is Leadership in the 21st Century, Moving from Good to Great. Undoubtedly, we are in a knowledge economy, and as such, a high premium is placed on intellectual capital, creativity, innovation, value, results, and a voracious appetite for continuous learning. Now that I have set the stage for the discussion, let me reinforce the point that community colleges are really making a difference in this regard. I read an AACC report. It was released in 2012. Where values meet values. The report highlighted the significant contribution community colleges continue to make to the U.S. economic recovery. No news here, but I think it's important to make a statement. There is a shortage of critical skills, such as STEM, advanced manufacturing, technician, machinist, and more. You are addressing these needs by graduating students across this country, students who are employable, students who are capable and students who are highly skilled. I tell you, having read that report, 2012 report, I was thrilled. And I will extract a quote from that report, AACC report. It says, through AACC's leadership, community colleges will be increasingly recognized as a gateway to the American dream by supplying resources to sustain America's economic viability and productivity. AACC, NSF, and ATE, you have individually and collectively made a difference. This is the era for community colleges. Please acknowledge that. And oh, by the way, folks, this is not something to be taken lightly. So I'd ask you to pause for a moment to celebrate your accomplishments. Now that we've celebrated, let me make a transition. The 21st century, by itself, has ushered in a new set of complexities. The workplace and the marketplace are dynamic, steeped with volatility and disruption. This is not going to change. This is the new normal. This is the new reality. This dictates that we cannot let the successes of yesterday or today distract from the successes of tomorrow. What got you here might not necessarily get you there. You have to constantly sharpen the tools in your toolkit to have sustained excellence and impact in an ever-changing and increasingly demanding environment. You're definitely in a growth mode, there's no question. While this growth is exciting, it is necessary to pause for a moment to recognize that with any growth, there will be new expectations, new challenges. New leadership skills and attitudes are required to reap the dividends from this growth. Understand that the leadership skills you acquire define your individual brand and the brand of the organization. Thus, I will highlight some skills that will distinguish you as a leader, particularly when changes occur. Allow me to ask a few rhetorical questions. All of you in this room, I consider you a leader. Recognize leaders at that. And when I use the term leader, I'm speaking of leaders at every level in the organization. From the very tenured to the person who just joined the organization. We are all leaders. So I'd like you to do an on-the-spot evaluation to determine if you're a good leader. Are you a good leader today? Will you be a good leader tomorrow? And I will pause to let you think about that. Will you be a good leader tomorrow? Those of you who are good leaders, let me tell you that it is essential that you seek to move from good to great. The potential to achieve greatness is possible. Jim Collins asserts that greatness is not a function of circumstance. Greatness, as it turns out, is largely a matter of choice. So you have a choice to be great. He goes on to implore us to acknowledge that good is the enemy of great. Good is the enemy of great. When we settle for being good, we are in essence laying the foundation for complacency. Please recognize that complacency can be a natural and insidious disease that can impede and deter the quest for greatness. The standards are steadily getting higher, and the demands greater. In order to move from good to great, leaders must develop a high tolerance for ambiguity and develop the skills to capitalize on complexity and disruption. We must seek to find the opportunities that reside within challenge and crisis. How are you showing up as a leader in the face of crisis and challenge? How are you showing up? Do you tend to retreat in the face of crisis? Or do you demonstrate resolve and resilience? Do you display the courage to make decisions with speed and at the same time reduce the margins of error? Are you still doing your self-evaluation? It is said that crisis builds character and crisis reveals character. Who are you in the face of crisis? Remember, the 21st century requires leaders to be adaptable and must model bold and courageous leadership. Life has a tendency to shrink or expand in proportion to the courage that you display. How our leaders deal with complexities of the workforce speak to who they are. The ultimate measure of a leader is not where you stand in moments of comfort and convenience, but where you stand at times of challenge and controversy, says Martin Luther King. Great leaders are able to find order in chaos and crisis. Leaders, where do you stand in moments of crisis? Where do you stand? Research has shown that prior to the recession, senior leaders and executive leaders spent much of their time making tactical and operational decisions. Learning from this experience, senior leaders are lowering the center of gravity by pushing operational decisions lower into the organization. Senior leaders must focus on strategic imperatives, external trends, and use analytics to provide foresight and insight. This allows senior leaders to identify early opportunities, potential issues, and inevitable future changes. You know, we have a habit, especially certain times of the year, where we have to measure this and we have to measure that. And we just store the results. I'm not talking about you guys. You don't do that. So let me tell you, leaders must use analytics to inform their decisions and guide their actions. Otherwise, we become data rich and insight poor. We become data rich and insight poor. Today's leaders must demonstrate an act to create and foster a climate that promotes collaborative learning, capitalize on the wisdom of teams, utilize collective intelligence to solve problems and innovate. Again, we are in a knowledge economy, and as such, Knowledge must be fluid across organizations and teams. Leaders must be the role models to break down organizational barriers and silos. The attitude of hoarding information is prevalent in many organizations, and our leaders must discourage this. When we hoard knowledge, we make knowledge a scarce commodity. Instead, knowledge is a shareable commodity, and when we share it, it multiplies. Organizational barriers, organizational inertia, and the unwillingness to share ideas and perspective across departments can lower the capacity for growth, innovation, and creativity. When organizations are in growth mode, it is especially important for teams to work together seamlessly. Again, we're erasing departmental barriers and borders. Develop a renewed sense of urgency and a focus on the strategic imperatives of the overall organization. It is said that great leaders have a special ability to instill a dual commitment in their people, a commitment to the success of their immediate department, and a commitment to the success of the overall organization. Working together should not be mandated. Instead, working together should be a natural process. Great leaders exhibit big picture thinking, simplification of process, discipline, and an understanding of the strategic imperatives. When leaders encourage a culture of knowledge sharing, the organization derives great benefits. For example, overall productivity increases. There's usually high employee performance and a high trust culture, which yields high employee engagement. Let me define employee engagement for you. Employee engagement is defined as a psychological state in which employees are intellectually and emotionally invested in the success of the organization. Engaged employees demonstrate passion, pride, and a desire to apply discretionary effort. In essence, loyalty. Cross-organization collaboration and collective achievement must be a priority for our leaders. There is a leadership gap in our workforce. And if we do not address the knowledge and leadership gap today, we put our organizations at risk tomorrow. The leadership bench strength is eroding. The question becomes, how will we develop and retain new leaders and at the same time identify replacements for baby boomers who are exiting the workplace at an alarming rate? Baby boomers are taking with them business critical intelligence, organizational memory, important tacit and experiential knowledge. We must recognize that demographic trends are irreversible and immutable. In order to sustain the successes and growth of this fine institution, provisions must be made today to transfer mission-critical knowledge and expertise to the next generation of leaders. Special effort must be made to define an organizational succession plan that allows continuity of the viability of the organization. It is about having the right people in the right place at the right time. Good knowledge transfer planning must be aligned with the strategic imperatives of the organizations, and leaders must engage in a process to identify current and future skill gaps in order to see the vulnerabilities. The intent is to create proactive actions and corrective actions. The senior leaders who are here today, do you know where your critical skills reside in your organization? Do you know who has those skills? Many people with valuable organizational knowledge and capability are in a position to retire. The imminent departure is an exposure of lost knowledge. I encourage you to read two books, Lost Knowledge by Robert DeLong and Deep Smarts by Dorothy Leonard and Walter Swapp. A few years ago, IBM and the Society for Training and Development conducted a study on the demographics of the workforce, and they found that many organizations are ill-prepared to address the needs and the potential problems of the changing demographics of the workforce. Additionally, the study found that mentoring is a major process to transfer knowledge. Mentoring promotes people connection, has the ability to harness experiential and organizational history, and has a proven business impact. As leaders, how much are you creating a mentoring culture? How much are you creating a mentoring culture? The next point I'd like to discuss is diversity. Realizing that diversity has been around, diversity is around, and diversity will be around. The stark reality is that diversity permeates everything that we do on a personal and on a corporate level. To overlook this fact is to jeopardize the promise and opportunity that diversity presents. Technology has added a new dimension to diversity. The more interconnected we become, the more we become one world. That one world is our marketplace. That one world is our workplace. That one world is our classroom. That one world is our community. The world is flat. Technology has erased geographic and cultural borders, and we have now become global citizens. Diversity issues have become more complex and multifaceted, and leaders must be in a position to manage diversity, but be leaders of diversity with the intent to foster a climate of inclusion. Effective leaders of diversity are self-aware, frequently self-evaluate. This helps them to understand the ramifications of such things as unconscious bias, implicit and hidden bias, and there's a new term for you, unintended honesty. These biases have the potential to fracture teams, derail progress, and tarnish the image and reputation of an organization. Courageous leaders take a stand to ensure that everyone in the organization is welcomed and valued and have fair and equal opportunities. Having organizational clarity regarding diversity and inclusion is a blueprint for our behaviors and determine the ways we respect differences. Collaborative learning is a common practice in our workforce today, and it is important to encourage the cross-pollination of disciplines. Create teams with different perspectives. teams that display diversity of thought, diversity of ideas, and diversity of approaches. This approach sets the stage for creativity and innovation, and ultimately dismantles the typical homogeneous thinking and discourages the attitude that this is the way we've always done things around here. Have you ever heard that? Good diversity and inclusion practices help to sustain organizational success and a climate where everyone thrives. Please understand that diversity is not a lesson. It is a practice. Diversity is an ever-evolving process in which we never stop learning. It's about respect and not tolerance, says Betty Hawes. And I will submit to you that none of us is as strong as all of us. And the ties that bind us are far greater than the issues that divide us. Diversity is not just a moral imperative. It is an organizational and business imperative. Great leaders build a bridge for inclusion, a bridge for trust, and a bridge for respect. Great leaders build esprit de corps among diverse teams. As leaders, and again, I'm speaking to leaders at every level. As leaders, how much and how often are we reinforcing the brand of this fine organization by the behaviors you model? And are you consciously making values-based decisions? A leader's brand is defined by the standards they set for themselves. We understand what leaders do much more than what they say. Remember, action speaks louder than words. Core values are enduring, and they define a set of expectations regarding the way we do business with each other and with the public. How you execute your organization's core values help you to define your brand. Let me offer you a quote. We are not measured by what we are, but by the perception of what we seem to be. Not by what we say, but how we're heard. Sometimes not by what we do, but how we appear to do it. Great leaders model integrity and ethical behaviors to build an organization's brand and reputation. And because of this, you inevitably build brand recognition, brand appeal, such that people will want to do business with you. You will always have repeat customers. Integrity and ethics must be a core component of the value system of your organization. Quite frequently, we hear of smart leaders who have failed because of lack of integrity and lack of judgment. The late John Wooden, Hall of Fame basketball coach for UCLA, said, "Ability may take you to the top, but it's character that keeps you there." I'm going to repeat it. Ability may take you to the top, but it's character that keeps you there. In the same vein, Martin Luther King says, "The true mark of a leader is not just knowing about what's right, but it is about doing what's right." How often do we compromise? How often do we go along to belong? Great leaders make integrity a priority for themselves and everyone in the organization. Folks, let me encourage you to maintain a maniacal focus on your goals. Be true to your purpose and your vision. Know when to reinvent your processes to meet new demands and constantly develop new thought leaders. Don't leave home without your moral compass. Always use your moral compass as your guide to make decisions. Bottom line, leaders and leaders at every level must demonstrate moral authority. Also, think creatively. Focus on agility and speed. Speed is a currency for business success. Believe in your people. Leaders become great not because of their power, but because of their ability to empower, suggests John Maxwell. Empower your people to achieve greatness. Instill hope in your people so that they're able to see the possibilities ahead. I began with some thoughts about greatness, and I will close just as I began. I consider myself a scholar of William Shakespeare. In his book, Twelfth Night, Shakespeare says, "Some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them." AACC, NSF, and ATE, you have achieved greatness by anyone's yardstick. I encourage you to stay steadfast and maintain a laser focus on excellence. You're on a journey, and what you have achieved thus far should be considered a milestone. The destination of your journey is sustained excellence and greatness. Do not allow any of your leaders and team members to stop at the intersection of mediocrity and good. Great leaders will take everyone along with them to the destination of excellence. Life is made up of moments. Doing the best in this moment prepares you to do even better in the next moment. So I say to you, carpe diem, seize the moment. And that's it.
Okay, so I hope you're thinking of questions for our speaker, because she's going to actually walk around the room so that you can ask her questions. So keep that in mind. But I just wanted to say that crisis, challenge, and complexity, in addition to all of us who are faculty and or we've got program directors and everyone else in the audience today, industry people, how about the students? Would you say that at certain times your lives were characterized by crisis, challenge, and complexity? Right? Yes, I would certainly say that. I think that the message we heard today is absolutely just as relevant for all of the challenges that you face, even in sometimes just getting to campus every day to be part of your program. So with that, I'm gonna let Sheila respond to your questions, and I'll come back up at the very end because I got a couple of other points to make.
All right. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Since I have the microphone, I think I'm going to pose the first question. How about that? You know, many companies today have defined self-care as a competency, particularly for their leaders, because there's a tendency to burn the candle at both ends. In fact, you will hear companies talk about work-life balance. I personally don't think there's a balance. Some people talk about work-life integrity. And the latest one is work-life harmony. Do you have harmony between work and your personal life? You know, as leaders and leaders at every level, how are you showing up? How are you showing up? Are you showing up with energy and enthusiasm? Are you focused? Do you know when you're reaching your tipping point? Do you know your threshold? Do you know when to step back and exhale? All right, so here's my question. I would like to have a bold leader step up to the microphone and let me know how you manage your personal care. Anyone? Anyone? And you have to tell us your name, too.
Yeah, that is the easy part. I don't know if I'm bold or crazy. My name is Dawn Wick, and I work at Southwestern Community College in North Carolina. I live in the Great Smoky Mountains, so it's gorgeous there. And as far as my self-care, stepping back, I teach programming, web development, and mobile development, which is all very logical. So my self-care is to step back and do creative things. I do a lot of art, metal art, bead art, mixed media, and also ride horses and do a lot of nature things, walking and hiking. So that's how I take care of myself and step back and just kind of
So you know when to read your bodily signals.
Yes.
Awesome. All right. I have a little reward for you. And the executives here, senior leaders, they have signed some words of wisdom to you. So let me ask you, which one would you want? Great.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
All right, I have, since I have the microphone. Yes, please, please. Your name?
My name is Mike Weixner. I'm from Augusta Technical College. And I couldn't help but just profess that I'm a Christian. And it's been through my faith in God and my love of Christ that has empowered me and emboldened me to really be strong. And it's through him and that relationship. So just wanted to pass that on.
Come and get your book. Okay. I would like to ask a student leader, can you choose? Students, where are you? Are there any students in here? All right, my question to you is, do you consider yourself a leader? And give me two leadership characteristics that you possess and how you live by them on a daily basis.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ricardo Muhammad. I consider myself a leader. I'm the oldest of 9 children. It kind of was thrust upon me. um, leadership kind of seems to fall into my lap too, wherever I go. Many of the students, my fellow students in class, have looked up to me. I didn't even ask for it, but I became the leader of the Renewable Energy Club at school. Somehow I found myself here at this great meeting, and this meeting is probably changing my life as I speak. It can be frightening at times, and I have a lot to learn. One of the things that I've realized is that I think I've been running away from that leadership role, and it's time now to kind of embrace it. I feel like many of us do the same. We are worried and afraid to take that.
I'm going to probe you a little bit. What is it in you why people would gravitate to you? There has to be an appeal. What is it? What's the characteristic?
I've asked myself the same question. I think it's a friendliness. Maybe I have a genuine interest in other people. I want to know who they are, how they feel, what they do, where they're going, why they're doing it. You know, I want to know how people are.
That's awesome. Yeah. You know, people connection is important, very important. And leaders who cannot connect to their people, they're not doing themselves well, nor the organization. Here you go. Thank you so much. Thank you. All right, your turn.
I have a comment. I'm Olga Valerio from El Paso Community College. I wanted to say your talk was very inspirational for me. It was great. And I would like to know if we are going to have a copy. You already encouraged us to be what is a leader, what we needed to do it. I'm Nadine from Advanced Technology Center. Maybe, let's say not 100%, but maybe 70%, all the characteristics that you gave it to us today, I try to apply. I try to connect. I try to tell my people, you are part of my family. Because we spend times together, 8 hours, 40 hours for the whole week. And when I wake up, when I go to work, like the gentleman said, before I go, I just pray and said, I'm here, this is my moment. You do whatever you have to do it and do the best for them. Thank you so much.
Gracious. Let me tell you something. I do presentations on career derailment. And generally, people don't necessarily derail or fail because of technical and functional skills. They fail because of people connection, relationships. So as much as you can create an environment that fosters healthy relationships, you're on your way. And thank you again. Another point I'd like to make about relationships. You hear people talk about soft skills, and that is becoming obsolete. And it's based on the notion that if these skills are so soft, why is it they're so hard to master? Huh? Can anyone clue me in? How are we doing? Any other question, comment, suggestions? If you don't, I have a question. I haven't heard from this side. Where? Oh, please.
All right. thank you for this. It's really inspiring to me. And I think one of the things that I've struggled with, and I'm feeling it right now, is allowing myself to admit that I can be vulnerable around people, and that other people are feeling that same thing. But when the other person was just talking, it sort of sparked in my mind that one of the skills that I'm trying to learn, or that I need to learn, is I always grew up with the idea that I should treat other people like I wanted to be treated. But one of the things I also need to learn is to treat myself like I would treat other people. And that is, right, that's hard. I mean, that's really hard. So like, I would want to, number one, in people that I lead, hope to allow them to be human. But I don't often give myself that. I tend to be very self-critical, and that holds me back. And I think that the other thing is, I like to try to inspire other people to find what's special or unique about them, but then I try to hold that back in myself. So I don't give myself the same credit or that same leeway that I try to give other people. And I think that's a skill that it's something that I recognize today, and I thank you for that. But I just thought I would share that with other people as well.
Before you go, there is a lot of literature on the concept of self-compassion. You can easily show compassion to others, but can you do the reverse?
Well, I think that's really difficult, and I know that I was just, I tutor somebody in stats, and I was just telling them the other day, they're working on their dissertation, and I said, when you're presenting this information, it's almost like you're apologizing for having it. And I have a tendency to do that as well. So if I write something, I want to find every justification for why that could possibly be right. Because I would say to another person, like, hey, I see this in you, and I want to encourage you. But then again, it's like, oh, well, how can I be the expert on this? Or how can I have expertise in this? You know. So anyway, I think that that's something that benefits everybody to start to think about, is you have to do that for yourself first, almost sometimes, before you can do that for other people, really.
When you go on an airplane, mm-hmm. and there's a child with you, what instructions are given to you? Put your mask on first, mm-hmm. so you can be right. of benefit to the child. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
I appreciate it. Okay, we may be running out of time, but I'm going to ask one question. You've been here for a couple of days, and I just want maybe two people to just get up and talk about some things that you picked up here. What resonated with you? And what are you taking back to your office? And when you get to your office, what do you intend to do with that information?
Again, me, I like to talk a lot. Let me tell you something. I get really impressed the first day I went to the conference to the entrepreneurial people for the STEM students. First of all, when I sit down, I said, I didn't like it. It's kind of boring, to be honest. But then, when I start to listening about boot camps for the students, and then coming from El Paso, where we have a bunch of low-income people and low-income students, and to be Hispanic, actually Mexican, I said, you know, the best way to help to people with low income is to make them to have their own business. I'm planning to go back to El Paso, start to offering summer camps, boot camps, how to do business by themselves, because I oversee welding, heating and ventilation, electrical, all these kind of careers that they can do their own business. I wanted that they have a better life. That's why I learned.
Folks, did you see the impact that you've made? I was just told I have a few more minutes. A second person, what are you taking away from this? Please, the microphone, sir.
Noticed about this conference is, and this is my third time attending, is we all show up here expecting to learn something, but we also show up expecting to present some information to other people. And one of the really interesting interactions that I've found every year is we all bring our own projects that we want to share with people, but we get feedback on those projects on how our particular focus could be shifted slightly. And we could apply our projects to many other fields. For example, our project is related to building automation, but it could definitely be used as an outreach tool in mechatronics as well, electronics, other fields. So that's one of the things that I find really enlightening in this conference, and we intend to take our project back and share it with some of the other departments at our school and let them take it, take what they will from it.
Awesome. I'm going to flip the script. And I'm coming to our senior leaders. What are you taking away from this conference? What are you going to do differently?
So I've been on both ends of this conference. I've come as an awardee, and now I find myself in the position where Dave and I are the co-leads of this program. And I am always amazed and awed at the amount of work, the excellent leadership that is exhibited in this room, not just from faculty, industry partners, but also the students. And I take that back every year, and it's one of the things that we will have discussions about. All of you know the solicitation had this particular one had its last deadline date. So we'll be having discussions about what are the important things that we've learned here that should inform writing and crafting the next solicitation. So this program continues to grow leaders, both within faculty, for the students, for everyone who's impacted by this program.
Thank you, thank you. I wish I had a book to give you. Dave, did you have any comments?
So you relieved a lot of guilt for me. So I'm not going to feel guilty anymore about turning off my phone at 5 o'clock and not answering emails over the weekend, spending more time with my wife. But also, sometimes I feel guilty when I'm writing a declination. So we decline more proposals than we make awards. And there's always this pressure to get the word out and get these things done and get it back to the PI. And sometimes, you know, I have a lot to say and I want to try to help that person improve for the next year. And sometimes I feel guilty. I really shouldn't be spending an entire day, you know, on this one proposal, writing up their my program officer comments, but now I don't feel guilty anymore, and I'm going to try to do as much as I can to help those people write successful proposals in the future.
Okay, I can turn it over back to you. Well, let me just tell you I'm humbled. Thank you for having me, and I'm hoping that at least one thing resonated with you. And I appreciate being in your presence. Thank you.
Okay, just one big note. Everybody who's got your conference program, has everyone looked at the back page where it gives you the dates for next year's conference? Okay, and especially for everyone who has been at this conference multiple times, our timeline has always been a Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. If you look at the back of your conference, we will be here at the Omni next year, but it will be a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. So I want to make sure everybody noted that and thought about the impact of that on your schedules now. And just a real brief explanation as to why that happened. Actually, Ellen and I might not really know, but Ellen went out looking, to finalize a contract. And she called me up. She said, every hotel in the entire, D.C. area is booked. And she said, I've talked to the Omni. They love having us. They really like having this conference here. But if we can't get everything finalized by this date, I'm not sure we're going to be able to have the conference when we want. So we worked really hard at NSF. We almost made it. But it will be a Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday next year. So everybody remember that. And then I just wanted to say, be sure you go to the showcase. I would also like to say that I know I asked Ellen, I said, did my email about everybody should showcase have an effect? And she said, it did. It really did. We've got more people that are showcasing than ever. We're kind of maxing out the exhibit area. I wanted to thank all of you who did it. And I know quite a few people have come up to me and said, I was really nervous about that. I signed up for it. I can't tell you how glad I am that I did it. I met more people. I've made more connections. What you said in your email was really correct. So I would like to thank everybody and thank you for the effort that you put in to do that. And this is, as always, it's been a truly amazing conference. So another thing, go home and tell other people about ATE. Tell them they should be part of this community. Bring them in. If I don't know how we'll do it at the Omni. I think we're kind of maxing out, but we'll figure it out. Let's grow our community. So thank you very much.